Okay, ladies and gentlemen, the next man standing is a veteran at Lenovo IBM. He led the formation of the pioneering and much talked about Lenovo Global Marketing Hub in Bangalore. He led the marketing, communication and advertising globally for Lenovo in that role and was instrumental in launching multiple global campaigns besides establishing WW Market Research and Analytics functions in Bangalore. The Lenovo Hub model henceforth has become a case study and has been adopted by many large organizations. He is currently the CEO of Lenovo India. Please welcome on stage Mr. Rahul Agarwal, who will now be talking to us about AI implications for organizations and individuals.
Am I audible at the back? Okay, I must say it's a little unfair because I'm the last speaker, I'm told, before the party begins. And the second part of unfairness is that I've been asked to speak on something about which I know very little. And leave aside expertise, like most of us, I'm trying to still learn my ropes on what this subject is. So let me start by asking, you've had 4.5 hours of intense discussions on AI. And I saw some very magnetic and powerful people who have come and spoken to you about. So has it improved your understanding of AI greatly? Do you feel semi-expert or half an expert? Any yes or no? Can't be quiet, guys. Party is just going to start, right? So you can start showing some energy now. Do you feel like an expert? More lost, okay. So if the answer is not a firm no, I think that's absolutely fine because we are all in the same boat. And in my view, the theater of AI has just begun and there are shows going on all the time. And this is one of the shows. And I think kudos to the organization for choosing this subject. And the attendance of this event, I think, is a testimony that people are keen to understand. But there's a lot being spoken about AI. It's this black box where people don't know what's really inside the black box. It's in this nebulous cloud which is kind of floating around us. People are talking about impossible stuff being done by AI. There is FOMO, fear of missing out. There's also fear of being irrelevant. And there are some people who are talking about fears of machines ruling the human beings. So I think it's a fairly interesting subject. And why am I here? The role that I am doing today is not really AI. But AI is relevant to all of us. So I was told that this community is largely a marketing community, a community quite dear to me because I was a part of this community till some time back. I still miss that life. And I was told that to bring out a flavor from a brand. How many of you, just a raise of hands, how many of you work for what we call brands, organizations? Very, very few. And how many are from the creative side? So, okay, all right, then what are the rest from? Media? All right, so I think you need to analyze the crowd because this just added up to 30%. So is there some category that I'm missing? No? Just shy? Tired? All right. So I'm going to assume that is mostly creative plus media. So I was told that, hey, bring out a flavor from an organization point of view. What is it that is bothering you? And how are you really going through this hazy path? Couple of things that made me feel comfortable with the subject was, one, Lenovo is actually doing a lot in AI. We started investing about 3 years ago. We've spent millions, hundreds of millions of dollars on AI. And the results have started showing. We've also invested in about 8 to 10 AI companies. And in the next 12 months, we are going to roll out products which will have AI as its backbone. So it's quite relevant to me. And there are a lot of conversations that are going on what can AI do for Lenovo. So it's quite relevant, but I must give a disclaimer that my own understanding is fairly primitive, and what I understand kind of gets dismissed after 3-4 months. So we're all together trying to learn this and see what is the implication on us, which is the theme of my pitch. So I don't have a clicker, so who's going to, is somebody going to click? This is in the podium. Okay, so I'm assuming that most of you have had some interface with AI. So when I was building the deck, I just wanted to probably put some basics to really reinforce that AI is not this fancy thing which is sitting in some other planet, but it's touching our life already. So all these things, when you talk to I don't know how many of you have a Lenovo PC, but when you talk to our after-sales service on the chat window, you may be talking to an AI-based chatbot, not a human being. Smart assistant and smart speaker, again, they use AI as a foundation to really be of assistance to you right there and then when you want it. And we've all been served ads, right? We've all been served ads, and many of us click on those ads. And the entire Google machinery is based on some of the most powerful AI engines. I think that is one organization which is really leading the whole application of AI. And social media, what gets served to us, we don't know, but what is getting served to us is customized based on our preferences. And this is getting more and more sharper. And the content is getting more and more customized without us realizing. Just sit with your friend and go on a social media and just go down. The sequence of content will be very different. So I think this is clearly a proof that AI is right in front of us. So what is AI? I don't know, Ashutosh, you must have covered it, but to me, I'm still trying to understand what is AI. And I don't know if people are clear about it, because the definition of AI is one thing, but to really understand what is AI is important before we get into the implication on marketing and organization and on us. And this is one definition that I liked a lot. And the key word here is human brain. Now, machines have outperformed human beings when it comes to the mechanical movement, right? Look at the car, look at the automobile. Machines in a factory, so that's no big deal. But they always needed a brain, a human brain, to manage the machine. Now AI, for the first time, is saying that, hey, can a machine actually mimic what a brain does? And in fact, does a better job out of it. And how can you do that? Because brain is a very complicated structure for two or three reasons. First is, brain has a lot of emotions. Emotions complicate life. Emotions complicate everything. Do we agree on that? Absolutely. Number two, our brain can get fatigued. After a few hours, you will feel tired. Your efficiency will go down. Number three, as you age, and it's an ugly realization, as you age, your brain slows down, with all due respect to my age category people. But you tend to slow down. And most importantly, the computing power of the brain is very limited. Right? It's very, very limited. Now, a computer, possibly with the right formula and algorithm, can do all this at a much better scale. At a much, much better scale. And the other key difference between AI and whatever has happened from computers and other analysis on analytics is that AI tends to make the machine learn. So even with very little data, the algorithm can actually learn on its own and come up with stuff that has not been programmed. And computerization till now has been all about programmed stuff. So if you need a brilliant software analyst, and a programmer who will predict the output, but use the computing power. But the key word here is learning. So if computers can learn, they can do a much, much better job than what a normal human brain can do. Of course, it has limitations, as I think we've heard from the panel. Again, a couple of charts. AI is not new. It's been around 1940, 1955, but nothing much happened till about 1990. And it's only in the last two decades that people have been talking more about it. And only in the last 6 to 7 years, when it's really becoming hot. So what is the AI continuum? I still, you know, want to spend a few minutes trying to help all of us, including me, understand what is AI. Now, there are three parts to the continuum, or to the spectrum. First is analysis. Now, data analysis is something that can be done by human beings. So in a sales environment, data analysis means you look at last 2 years sales data and then analyze, hey, my sales go up in the third month of the quarter, and you know, these are my most profitable customers. A simple analysis, right, where human beings really pretty much analyze, but computers can help. Second is analytics. Now, analytics for the same data can tell you who are your most profitable customers and who are the customers who are likely to come back to you. Analytics can also tell you what are they likely to buy in a limited way. Now, AI is actually just an extension of this. It just goes a few steps forward and says, look, you've analyzed the data, you've got some analytics, but AI can actually reach out to those customers on its own with the customized offering and actually give a pitch. And that is where AI starts replacing human beings in some ways, and which is why we all are all talking about the jobs getting killed or replaced by human beings. But it's a reality. Many of the email marketing jobs will become obsolete. Email marketing is surely not going to happen. Targeting, segmentation can be done automatic if you have the data. So that is how you got to remember AI. It is not something fancy, that just like a blockchain. Blockchain is very difficult to understand and explain. But this is actually just deeper analysis with the power of brain and something that learns on its own. So why is AI gaining prominence? Don't want to bore you with the stuff, but data, there's so much of data being generated. You know, all the data that we have today in any history is 90% of that was created in the last 2 years. So that's the kind of data we are creating. Computing power, I think everyone knows how fast the computing power is growing and how it is actually getting commoditized. Anybody can get access to the supercomputers today. And lastly is the algorithm. I think Google again has taken the lead, and the whole beauty of their programming and the whole beauty of reasoning, which actually lays the path for any AI engine to function, is happening now. So it's basically the convergence of these three factors that is really making AI explode. These are some applications. Some of them are there in India. Some of them are not there yet. But in many parts of the world, these applications are alive, and they're making a difference to how people either provide services on products or receive products and services. So I don't know how many of you have heard of this. I think everyone has heard of the Deep Blue. But can anyone stand up and say what is the common thing between these three? Yeah. So these are examples. So these, there are three examples. Let me show. So on the left is Garry Kasparov. He's supposed to be an extraordinary. He's supposed to possess an extraordinary brain, which can process information much faster than normal human beings, right? Because when you're playing chess, there are millions of permutation combination on every move, right? So for the first time, a computer could beat it, and nobody can program anyone how to play chess, because the permutation combinations are so huge. Secondly, Watson, again, IBM has done some path-breaking work on AI. This is a game called Jeopardy, which is played in the US, very complicated game. And, there was this game that was played some time back, and again, Watson was a winner, and people just didn't predict it. And lastly, there's a game called Go. I don't know how many of you are aware of Go. It's a very complicated game, and everyone predicted that, look, there's no way any computer can beat anyone on this game, and the same happened. So these are some extreme examples. There are some daily life applications, but this shows you what the power of AI is. And remember, this happened 20 years ago. 97 is when Deep Blue defeated Kasparov. So now let me actually come to the subject, which is what are the possible implications of AI to an organization like Lenovo. And it's important for all of you to understand, because if you are working for an agency, then this is relevant for your clients. And if you can partner with them in this journey, I think you'll get a better place in their space. So first is product innovation. You know, can we actually give customers what they really want? Do we have products which are based on AI, like a voice assistant? But more importantly, can AI help you to build products which customers really need, analyzing all the data that we have? Pricing. Now, it's one of the most complicated subject is pricing. In our consumer business, we sell more than 100 different SKUs. And they're sold in different routes. And it's a very difficult task to decide what to price where. And no human mind can do it. And at the end of it, it's fairly subjective, it's rough. I think AI can help us do the optimal pricing for maximizing our profitability. People. Now, this is where AI has not really been used. But anybody who has hired people knows how subjective that whole process is. Despite some test and assessment and all that. But AI can actually help us tell who are the people who are more likely to succeed because of the cultural fitment, because of their capability. And this is a huge, huge value add that can happen to organizations. Marketing, I'm not going to spend time on it because I think enough must have been spoken about it. But this is something that is happening, right? A lot of this is actually live. You know, we do digital marketing, and it's customized. Google and Facebook and other folks tell us, hey, you know, give us 29 creatives, and they will be served to 29 different kind of customers. And that segmentation and positioning is constantly changing based on what your brief is. Retail and distribution. Now, again, it's a very unstructured field. We have about 10,000 stores, small or big in India, who sell Lenovo. Now, which city should have how many stores? Which town should have how many stores? What is the optimal retail footprint that we require? It's all very subjective. It's only based on some rudimentary analysis. And there is enough evidence to say that if we have the right data over the last few years, an AI engine can actually tell us. And I'm sure the Watson engine actually is ready today to do that. And, the last is after sales transformation. Can we actually do preventive maintenance through our AI engine, self-healing PCs or chatbots, which we use today? And by the way, a lot of companies have started using chatbots. So this tells you that, all the four P's of an organization can get vastly enhanced by AI. And it's up to organizations to decide whether to, to be a follower or to take a lead and get that competitive edge. So, in essence, these are the three things that AI can bring to an organization, to any brand. First is better customer focus, better products, better targeting, better pricing, better availability. So absolutely, I think the goal of all organizations finally is to serve the customers in the best possible way. And if you do that, the shareholders' value gets maximized, your bottom line gets maximized. So that's the overarching benefit. Second is efficiency, cost. You do things faster, you scale up faster. And lastly is product, because sometimes you don't realize how difficult it is to innovate a product. And if you look around, you'll see there are very few companies who are able to do a good job of true product innovation. And the reason is that the whole process is very flawed, and it's way too subjective. And I think AI can play a big, big role there. So how's Lenovo using AI? I think this is the last part of my presentation, having tried to explain what is AI and what is the implication of AI for an organization, where it can potentially touch all aspects of the organization. And by the way, you know, it's like what happened in the last 15, 20 years. Two things started touching all aspects of our life. One is computer, and second is internet. So we can't even imagine what it can do. Any function, any process that an organization is doing today can be done in a vastly different manner with the intervention of AI. So these are some of the things that we are doing. So, you know, our supply, you know, we do after-sale service, and there are millions of spare parts that are relevant for us, because products change every year. And we have globally thousands of warehouses where we stock. Now, which spare part to stock where is extremely important. Because if you don't get your part the next day, you know, our CSAT goes down. So we are using a very advanced AI engine to do the stock planning, again, based on past data. This is on the cusp of analytics and AI, because this is very high-end analytics, but, you know, the AI engine is actually now meant to automatically order and reorder for each of the warehouses. So this will become kind of auto mode. There is a case study we've done. There is in China, we are doing a diagnostic assistance for cancer, where, you know, we've done a prototype where remotely, just by looking at the cells of the cancer, experts in the U.S. can actually tell what is the degree of the cancer and what is the possible treatment. And we all know that while cancer is by and large a much better disease to treat, but a lot of people still run to the developed markets to get it treated. We've already launched smart speakers and assistants, you know, which are a live example of this. Chatbots, we already use chatbots for our after-sales service. And I had the opportunity to look at a retail solution that we have, where we have what we call a manless store. So that store actually recognizes your face as you get in. And when you go in, it, you know, because of your face recognition, it has your past buying history. It will recommend your bag. And then when you check out, it just looks at your face, and it will debit your payment, which is linked. So you can just walk in and just walk out in about 90 seconds with your bundle of goods. So it's an amazing solution that we have. And I don't know, we might not launch it in India because there's no shortage of people here. And pilferage is a big issue, but I think a lot of our European and US markets are getting very excited with this solution. Now, some of the other things where we are doing research, I think speaker we've already launched. There's a smart service assistant which will go beyond the chatbot. The speech activity recognition, so when people are talking to us on the call center or after sales, depending on their voice, you know, our pitch will change. And this is very important when people are agitated, when this problem is not getting solved. And smart supply chain. I think supply chain in the industry that we work in, whether it's phones or computers, is very complicated. So we are doing some advanced AI trial there. So net-net, I think Lenovo has got one foot into this, and we have realized the potential of AI. One more example, which is not mentioned here, is ShareIt. How many of you have heard of ShareIt app? Yeah. So who owns ShareIt? Do you know? So ShareIt is owned by Lenovo. Yeah. It's a stupidly guarded secret. And do you know how many active monthly users are there on Facebook in India? Somebody spoke about it. How many? 200, 225. And India is the largest market for Facebook. Guess what the number is for ShareIt? 200 million. 200 million. So it's almost there. So it's an amazing asset that we have, and they're using AI to serve proactive videos. So if you are a ShareIt user, you probably are being served videos, and feel good that they are customized, personalized videos for you. They may not be the best today, but that is what is also using the AI engine. Now, what is the implication on all of us as individuals? Forget that we work for an organization, and forget that you have clients that you got to cover. I think one thing is we got to feel good about the fact that it will make us more productive. It will declutter our life. I don't know, self-driving cars in India, I keep telling people it's impossible. It's impossible, and people dismiss it. But that's what they say. But forget that. But smart homes, smart refrigerator, it will make our life very, very convenient. The refrigerator will order on its own. The washing machine will order the washing powder on its own. The smart home assistant will, do a whole lot of things that today you kind of run around. So it will make our life better. It will also give us better choice. So today, if you want to buy a computer, tell me, is it an easy decision? Or a TV? Let me not bias you with computer. When I want to buy anything, it's a mind-boggling journey. There's so many permutation combination, and there is no guide to tell me what is the right product for me. My daughter came to me sometime back and said she wanted to buy a computer, and I was like, I just put her onto the product manager, who confused her further. So nobody really knows what is the right product. Even my product manager could not tell my daughter what is the right product. In the end, he says, how much does your father want to spend? And my daughter actually came. She's 10, so, she didn't know that she should not be asking me this question. She should be going for the lowest price product. But she actually came and asked me. So this is how confused we are about what to buy. I think AI will help us choose our products better. Investment, all of us invest in mutual funds and this and that. Again, nobody knows what is the right thing. But based on AI models, different profile of people will get the right choice. So I think our life will definitely improve as a customer. As an employee, again, I think our productivity will improve because a lot of jobs will be done by AI engines. And we'll be able to do much more than what we are doing today. So marketeers, so I think you'll be able to show a lot more value add to your clients on media management. Creative efficacy, the whole ROI measurement, I think there'll be far more effectiveness if you have the right AI tools. And the other thing is about, skilling. That there is a fear of being outskilled. I think it's a little overstated because when industrialization happened and when computerization happened, they all said that the machines will take over the humans, but that never happens because we have an uncanny ability to not just tide over technology, but ride over technology and master it. So while there are some fears of AI reaching the shores of human cloning, and one should have the humility to say one doesn't know what one doesn't know, but I think by and large, the future is always full of hope and as well as paranoia. And I think, we need to stay calm and we need to learn, just know what's going on, which is my last slide, that therefore what does it mean for all of us? I think it means that we need to know that this is happening. And this is not just a small technology change. It's a massive technology change that will affect all of us in a good way as well as in a not so good way. And the not so good way is that we will get out of our comfort zone. All our jobs will get affected. All our jobs will get affected. Somebody like me worries that what if my competition takes a lead? That's a big worry, right? If my competition takes a lead, then they have a better competitive edge, right? So as a consumer, I'm happy with the stuff that is happening. But in my role, I'm worried about it. So I think all of us need to improve our understanding. And I think attending this meeting is maybe the right thing to do, but that's not enough. We got to go back and keep improving. There's a lot of published material by McKinsey. I think there are three organizations who are doing path-breaking work: McKinsey, IBM, and Google. And McKinsey is actually on this path of publishing. They're sharing what they're learning. So we must educate ourselves and keep upskilling. I'm sure there'll be a lot of AI stuff that will come out. A lot of courses will happen. A lot of digital courses will happen. And lastly, as I said, it's important to keep calm and not get paranoid, because people do get paranoid, and Jack Ma made a statement that millions and millions of people are going to get employed, and he's a great visionary. We must remember what he said, but I think we must also keep our calm and know that nothing is going to happen overnight. No change in this world happens overnight. Very few things happen overnight and completely change our life. So as long as we are keeping our ears on the ground and keeping ourselves aware of the implications and skilling, I think we are good. So I think that's about it, and I've completed my time slot. We don't have time for Q&A, and anyway, I'm not the expert on AI. I was asked to share my view. I've done that, and hopefully some of you will remember what I said. Thank you.
I'd like to invite on stage Shilpa Shetty, National Sales Head, BTVI, to please present a memento to Rahul, our way of saying thank you for your time and your participation.
Thank you,
Shilpa, for doing the honors, and thank you, Rahul, once again for your participation here at the E4M Conference.